morning. Welcome to another episode of Let's Talk OMMA. I'm your host and agency PIO, Portia Riley. Today, I'm joined by Adam Crabtree, the CEO and founder of NCS Analytics. Thanks for taking the time to talk with us. How are you?
Doing pretty well. Thank you for having me on the podcast.
We're super excited to have you. So I will get right into it. First, explain what NCS Analytics is and what you all do for people who may not know.
So we are a data analytics firm based in Denver, Colorado. We focus on the high-risk data element, so typically cash-intensive or traditionally higher-risk businesses. So alcohol, smuggling, bootlegging, sales suppression, all of those fun ones that give government agencies and financial institutions heartburn. Our biggest sector, though, is cannabis. And so depending on which state and which sector we're in, we grab between 8 and 15 data streams, backwards, forwards, upside down, and sideways through our patent-pending predictive and behavioral analytics.
Then can you talk about partnering with us to create the OMMA dashboard? I feel like it's already gotten so much traction and so many people are excited about it.
Yeah, of course. So the dashboard, or as we lovingly call it, the Transparency Project, is our outward-facing aspect of what we do. And so a lot of the tools we build are for internal use, for the agencies we work for, like OMMA, for financial institutions. But the Transparency Project takes all of that work that we do and that OMMA does and allows the general public to see and understand how much you guys are actually doing. A lot of what we do is helping the agencies we work for to be more effective and more efficient. And so there's no doubt you guys have a large and growing market. So bringing in tech tools to help assist, help them focus where their efforts are needed most, showing them how the market is changing and evolving, and it allows them to be more impactful and more efficient at the same point in time.
There are some updates that have recently been made. Can you talk about the upcoming changes people can expect to see?
Yeah, so the dashboard is actually going to be updating to move to a weekly refresh to where the citizens of Oklahoma will be able to see what's going on as of last week. To help with that change, we added in some new widgets to where you'll be able to see how the market is trending, get a better overall understanding of what's going and how it's going and all of those kind of fun information facts.
This dashboard offers Oklahomans a near real-time look at what's happening in their state. What do you hope they take from it?
I hope that it gives context to the hard work that OMMA has to put in. You guys have a very large market. It's still pretty young, so there's a lot of changes. There's a lot of evolution there. And so helping them to understand how many millions of plants or how many hundreds of millions of dollars of sales, all of those things that the team over there is responsible for overseeing. So if they take nothing else away from this, it's just looking at how truly impressive your market is and giving context to the amount of work it takes to handle it.
If I'm a licensee or member of the general public just interested in the industry here, what can I expect as far as a breakdown of the OMMA dashboard if I go to view it?
So you're going to be able to see everything from how many active licenses are going, how much total sales are flowing in the state of Oklahoma each month, even fun facts like as markets evolve, you'll notice a change in the products that are sold. So by category, you'll see them shift from one to another, and that's part of market maturing. You'll be able to see, like, are the crops getting larger, getting smaller? Are we growing more each month? And so all of those interesting aspects from the different verticals of cannabis to give you a better understanding of what's happening in within the state and all the hard work OMMA's putting in to make sure that it's done correctly.
How did the Transparency Project come about? Like, where did that idea stem from?
So it was in response to what our clients were asking and also what people were asking from us. I feel like cannabis is one of those great unknowns because it is one of the first truly new industries in a long time. And so people wanted to understand, like, well, what are the sales look like? How many plants are growing? How do we understand what's happening? And so we were fielding a lot of those requests for our clients, and then our clients would pass on requests from the average citizen that wanted a better understanding. And we were fielding so many of those that we sat down and started brainstorming, like, how do we make this data available? But we wanted to make sure we made it available in a way that was engaging. So you'll notice there's tooltips and the dashboard moves and changes, and there's ways that you can dig in further. but we also had to ensure that we didn't compromise anyone's privacy, safety, or security. And so that's why the dashboard is at an aggregate level to where we can share all of the interesting things that are happening without it compromising anyone's right to privacy and things like that.
When we're looking at this dashboard, it's very easy to see what we're looking at. In regard to what went into it behind the scenes, I'm sure it was a lot more complicated.
In any given week, we digest between 40 and 60 million data points. And so being able to bring that all together, analyze it, aggregate it, and then display it is a pretty Herculean task. And so I would say the hardest part is to making it look easy. We've spent a lot of time on the design elements, a lot of time making sure that it's engaging, and most importantly, a lot of time on the security of that data to where we feel comfortable having it out there, having it published, and having people see it. We're also responsible for the numbers that are in there, so making sure that they are accurate and informative. It takes quite a bit of work to make it seem simple.
Why cannabis?
So I actually come from banking. I like to joke that I'm a recovering banker. And so I was sitting in an office, you know, 7-8 years ago, wondering how I could bring part of the cannabis industry onto my balance sheet and what would have to happen to get compliance comfortable and how we would go about it. And I actually have a background in mathematics. And so I started writing analytics that would show that every dollar being deposited was from a state legitimate sale. And so you have to do that with a pretty high degree of statistical certainty. So one thing led to another, and I actually got thrown in front of the then marijuana czar here in Colorado, Andrew Friedman, and he posed the original question to me: if banks can get to this level of detail, why can't the government use it? And so took that home and unpacked it and realized that both in the financial services industry as well as the governmental sector, there is an underserved need for tools that can make things more efficient, more impactful, being aware of cost and all of those kind of things. And that's where NCS was born.
Cannabis industries are often very complex. What are some of the top challenges you all have faced as far as implementing your resources?
They are without a doubt complex. I would say that one of the big challenges for a company like ours is we operate in so many different areas across the country that each state has its own rule set. Obviously, there's the overarching rules. We want to make sure that it isn't inversion, diversion, it's not harming children, any of those things, but each state has their own flavor onto what's allowed, how things are done. And so that's one of the big challenges. The other, coming back to the newness of it, is so much of this is still being figured out. I mean, the theoretical oldest regulated cannabis market, specifically on the adult use side, is Colorado, and it's barely coming up on a decade. And so it's one of those that it's continuously evolving and changing. Every new state brings a different flavor. There's always things happening at the federal level that are casting different types of lights on where things are going and how it's going to be done. So it's pretty interesting industry to be in.
How do these partnerships with your company come about? Do you all reach out to states with cannabis programs, or do they reach out to you?
Early on, it was a lot of reach out by us, convincing government agencies that you can provide them valuable insight in near real time. You would have thought that I was peddling black magic. We often joke that it was nothing but voodoo, or that's how it was perceived, until we started showing results and showing impacts. And now it's starting to shift where we're getting reach outs. I had a cannabis czar, as they like to call themselves, reach out and say, "Hey, I was told you were the person I need to talk to. Here are the challenges I'm facing." And so we're seeing a shift in that. We're seeing the understanding that tech can really help them with the pretty monumental things they're tasked with. So it's been a nice change, but that's a fairly recent one.
You all serve several different states. How big of a team do you need to be able to do that?
I actually have a phenomenal team, small and mighty. The platform itself actually operates predominantly autonomously. That ensures that we're not having bias in there. It's not getting in the human error factor. And so I've got a small team. We're 15 to 20. We are continuously growing, scattered all over the country, serving different aspects of it. But thankfully, the way that we've been built, the platform is able to handle the majority of its tasks with very little human interaction.
With each state having their own set of rules, was there any state that presented unique challenges?
No, I would say that each state gives us things that we can learn from, things that we can make suggestions on. Every state has its own interesting aspects to it. And so I think that each one is just the next evolution. And then it's fun because not only are there new states coming on that are looking to the existing for guidance, but there's also some of the early states that are now going into version two. They're going back and changing their rules and regs, or they're looking at how their market's going forward. So it's not only are the new markets bringing insight, but some of the original markets are coming back with the lessons learned to change and make the market better and stronger and more stable going forward.
How much research goes into what you all do?
So the dashboard in general took quite a long 3 to 6 months of figuring out the look and feel and how we would update the data and what it would look like, how we would secure it, how we would publish it. Thankfully, the framework of that was the biggest aspect. So then as we bring on additional states, the biggest portion of that's already done. And then it's just tailoring it to the individual states, whether it's changing what the licenses are named or what specifically is important to that agency. And so most of the framework was done when we did our first state, and now it's substantially less for each subsequent.
I know you mentioned the look and design. I feel like people sometimes don't realize how much goes into that. It is a very complex process.
And I will 100% own, I am much more comfortable staring at a database or staring at spreadsheets because I am a numbers dork. But thankfully, I surround myself with some people that understand what colors go together and why things clash and also how to make it engaging. So I've got some phenomenal people on my team. They're very good at that look and feel. They're able to create it in what's called wireframes, which are basically just design elements. And then they pass those on to the people that take those design elements and put them into code to where they coincide. But I will own that is not my forte. I'm a numbers and spreadsheets dork.
It's always nice to have those people on your team that balance your weaknesses because together, our strengths with others' weaknesses, vice versa, makes for a better outcome.
Couldn't agree more.
Tell me a little bit about your background in regard to how you got to where you are today.
As I mentioned, I was in banking, and it was just one of those that when we were presented with the question about banks and governments both being able to use this, and it just was the right time in my life that I looked and I was like, if you're going to take a swing and start your own business, now is the time to do it. And that was 6, 7 years ago, I guess, at this point. And so I've been pretty dang lucky that it was able to work out for us, and we've been growing pretty rapidly ever since.
What is something that you and your company are constantly striving to achieve?
So back to me being a dork, we are always trying to find new ways and new data sources. One of our newer data sources and newer abilities is things like bringing in utilities data, because that gives us information that we wouldn't be able to get elsewhere, and it can provide insight to regulators that they wouldn't otherwise have access to. Or one of the new analytics toolkits we released earlier this year was a behavioral based as opposed to a pure analytics. And so our job, and it's what we love most, is figuring out new ways to evaluate and bend and look at the data with different statistical treatments and applications and tools to provide our clients with better insight. I don't think there's any better feeling than when we release a new capability and it gets validated in the field of, hey, I tried this, this works, you were right. It's a pretty awesome feeling. A bit nerdy, but it's a pretty awesome feeling.
No, that's amazing. And you have quite the resume. In all that you've done and created, what are you most proud of?
As far as what we're most proud of, I would say that it actually is the transparency project. So much of what we did was behind closed doors, and we didn't have a way to outwardly show not only what we were doing, but what our partner agencies were doing. And so being able to evolve this to where we can share it, we can show those conversations. It's phenomenal for us to watch from the backside how many people are actually looking at this, viewing it, understanding what we're doing. And so that I would say is one of the only public aspects of what we do, because so much of it is constrained to inside our clients' organizations.
And then lastly, it's the hardest question of all. I ask every single person that comes on this podcast, What do you like to do outside of work?
Outside of work? I don't think I understand the question. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. So outside of work, I really enjoy the outdoors. Being from Colorado, that presents four seasons worth of outdoor activities, fishing and hunting and camping and all of those things. As much as I live around tech, one of my favorite things to do is find myself in an area where I get absolutely no cell phone reception, and I just get to indulge.
That's the best. Just having that time to just relax and really disconnect with social media, the internet. It's so wonderful. And you're so lucky to be in Denver doing it. I love Denver.
Yes.
Well, thanks again so much for sitting down with us.
This was great. I really appreciate it.
And thanks to the listeners for tuning in to another episode of Let's Talk OMMA.